Hello, I'm Rick Love for Sonoma TV's Filmmaker Interview Series here at the 2019 Sonoma International Film Festival. And we have with us writer-director Rohina Guerra and producer Brice Poisson, who have brought their film Sur to the festival, and it has been selected as the closing night feature at this year's festival. So congratulations on that. Also won an audience award earlier this year at the Mill Valley Film Festival, so very exciting. It's about a prosperous young Indian man who falls in love with his servant, a widow with a dream of becoming a tailor. So despite growing income inequality in America, we hear about that all the time, social mobility is still possible here. It's with a great idea and backing. Absolutely. You can. It makes it hard for us to understand the caste system. In India, and how prevalent is that system? And is social mobility? I know it's gotten better, but is it still? If you have the great idea and the support, can you still advance?
So first, I just want to clarify that the film talks about the class system, not mm-hmm. really caste. And I think that the way that we deal with class in India probably has its roots in the caste system, mm-hmm. in the way that you see people as fundamentally not equal. You know, so by definition, like you can, because you, and then you define the person's place in society by the job that they do. And that, so therefore you see someone who's a domestic worker as somehow fundamentally different from you, which is something that I think is qualitatively very different in the US. Because here I think the assumption is, of course, people are equal. It's opportunities that make you different, right? Mm. That said, I think in India there is social mobility in a certain way. It depends from which class to which class. You see, so you maybe the offspring of a domestic worker, the child, the son, daughter, whatever, could study. And that's really what they do. People really focus on education in India for them to change their lives. And they believe that the next generation will have it better. And they often do. Mm-hmm. So you really often will have a domestic worker who's educating her daughter. The daughter's going to college, you know, so is dressing very differently from the mum. Changing her life and aspiring to a completely different life. So there is social mobility, but while you play a certain role in society, like when you are very specifically a domestic worker, that relationship is very codified, you know.
So it is like caste a little bit.
Yes, exactly. It plays out like caste, but we don't really call it that, and we don't really admit or even face up to it, you know. Mm-hmm. Like it's like we're living with 1950s segregation in the US, you know, mm-hmm. but no one's fighting against it. Like you don't, like a domestic, a person who works in your house will not drink from the same coffee mug as you, you know. She won't eat from the same plate as you. She'll eat in your house, she'll sit on the floor in the kitchen and eat off of a steel plate, but she will not use your silverware or your plates, you know. So that's segregation.
That is very different. That is very different than what we have here.
And that's why the film, for me, it was important to talk about this, you know.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. So we have what we refer to as white people problems. And what's interesting is your character, Ashwin, despite having, so many more opportunities, he essentially is suffering from this malaise of, like, what is your problem? When you have so many more opportunities, why can't you just get up and go? So it's very interesting. You've got the juxtaposition of your female lead and your male lead.
Yeah. So for me, it was important that the story be told in a way that it's not that she's a victim and he's the oppressor. You know, mm-hmm. there's a very typical way sometimes of seeing these dynamics. And it's not at all the case. In many ways, she's more dynamic, she's more free, she's more optimistic, she's fighting for her dreams. And he's kind of, you know, trapped by circumstances in this sort of gilded cage within which he lives. Because he's got all the privilege and opportunities in the world, but he's still trapped with his sort of obligation to society, his feeling of, filial obligation to his parents, all these things. So he's really sort of trapped within upper-class Indian society, doing things by the rules, whereas she's much freer because she has nothing, but she has a dream, you know? So I've kind of turned these things on their heads a little bit,
right.
These expectations, you know?
Hearing you describe it, it's almost like he's more limited by caste than she is. Based on just the idea of what we would take as being someone who is free.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And I think that sometimes privilege can be very dangerous in the way that it limits you, you know, in the way that you feel you need to reinforce or consolidate your privilege instead of being free. You know, sometimes you can be free or take the risk of being a writer or being a director, when you feel you have nothing to lose, you know, mm-hmm. if you don't have like the big family business that you need to take care of, because that's such a big cost to walk away from that and to actually just do something completely different, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So
Brees, how did you come to be involved in this project, and what was it like for you working with this? It's interesting because your story, you know, the love story is a universal story, but because of your setting and because of the socioeconomic implications of it, it's got a unique twist on that story.
For me, it's much more being a privileged guest, I would say, on this project, because Rowena had set up already, she'd met the DOP, everything was really well made, the funding was in place, and I came on just to make sure things were running smoothly. And what's really interesting is to be present with Rowena since the inception of the concept and seeing it growing, evolving, and talking about the possibility of this co-production, and then having this French team working with the Indian guys, and seeing just how things just played out, and then you have a call suddenly, like the film is selected to Cannes. It's like wow, and then it's growing and growing and growing, and it just I think it's a blessing for a first film and an inexperienced producer, I would say. But it's amazing. It's really amazing to be part of it.
So Brees really helped to put together the whole Indo-French co-production, and so he's actually the Indian producer on the film,
mm-hmm.
and he's a French co-producer.
Mm-hmm.
So he actually helped cobble together the way that it was going to run, and it was Brees's idea to really insist on getting our sound engineers from France and really setting the sound up, you know, raising the quality and the way that the sound is approached in France, because I think those are the things, you know, it's really in the detail sometimes that you can be let down. I was very clear all along that I wanted a French DOP on the project, you know, the director of photography.
Interesting,
and, really
and that was for there was an artistic. How would that impact the production? What we'd see up on the screen?
I've lived away so much, you know. I've lived in the U.S., I've lived in California, I've lived in New York, I've lived in France. So for me, the way that I see India is a little bit different from the way someone who's always lived in India sees India. So it was important for me that somehow be integrated, but very subtly into the film, you know, to have here's my story, but just the way that you see when you see a street scene, to really capture what also the outside eye sees, because I see things in both ways, you
mm-hmm.
know. So I still do notice the chaos, which you don't notice when you live in Bombay too much, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, it was important to have an external eye, and I'm very comfortable with the way French people approach things artistically. The way I love Dominique Collin's work, the DOP that we finally got. I actually didn't think I could ever get him, you know. So that was really. And that's something I really appreciated. Like when he read the script, he said, I'll do it. And I said, look, I don't even know how to talk to you about money, because we have no money. Like this is really like an independent, tiny budget film. And he said, well, that's the privilege that I have, that I can choose what I do. And mm-hmm. I'm doing it. And then we'll figure out the money. You know, and that kind of approach is something I really appreciated. So, yeah, it was him specifically, but I was also clear that I wanted to have that external approach. And with Brees coming to take over on the production side, and he said, no, let's go further, push it further. You know, let's try to get, a French sound engineer. Let's try to. And then when we decided we could do it as an Indo-French co-production, and we decided we can do the edit also in France.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so Jacques Cometz, who's a very established editor who teaches at FEMIS, he just retired. He came on board to edit the film. So then, you know, it's those people who make your film, having a really solid crew.
Right.
You know?
It's interesting too, having the perspective of people who aren't from the area, and perhaps approaching it in a different way, and seeing things differently, and maybe not taking things for granted because they're not things that they're used to, and being able to see it. That makes sense to me, actually. Even though it's all behind the camera, it would be a different film.
If it had
come through a Bollywood branch or something like that, a very, very different film.
And even sound, you know, it's so subtle, but like when you watch the film, you can hear, we shot everything on location, which Bruce really supported, and but it was really difficult. Because Bombay is extremely
in that
noisy,
city,
it's
noisy,
expensive, there
crowded,
are people everywhere.
The like permitting and all, I can't imagine what that must have been like.
That was
the
like
permitting was very challenging.
Yeah.
Because when you have all the permission, there's always someone who pops up on the screen. Right?
Just like, hey, what about me?
Yeah.
Where's me?
Exactly.
You didn't get me. You paid the 12 guys ahead of me, but where's mine?
We had that.
Yeah, probably just here's my money belt, and I'll just take care of this so we can get this shot.
Yes, it was that negotiations.
Constantly, yeah.
But what was very interesting for me was Dominique on set, who was like I've never seen someone working like without any idea of shifts of hours. I remember when he came on board, he was like, I like discovering new countries, but I don't like being a tourist. And coming here, working with you guys on that, will allow me to go inside the culture. And it was really interesting to see contrast of work, because he's very minimalistic in his approach of lighting. Mm-hmm. And they have a much more grand way of looking at lighting. And they were like, no, but that's not going to work. You have too little. Should we get more lights? And he was like, no,
yeah,
don't worry.
Yeah, we wanted, you know, because the reference, one of the references I'd given Dominique was In the Mood for Love. You know, in terms of the look of the film. So obviously, but Indian films, so your Indian crew who's used to Bollywood, which is much brighter.
Color saturated, super everything's so lit all the way to the corners of the screen.
Yeah. So Reese had like, the EP and people coming to him, and obviously nobody would tell me, you know, can't we create chaos on the set, but they would go to the producer and say, I think he's not. Can you tell them to turn it up a little bit?
Only two people are wearing red in this shot. Can that be possible? It's a film being made in India.
We actually brought in a colorist with a mini
NDI.
So we would check the frames, and Dominique would be like, it's fine for me. And they would be like, okay, now the producer knows, director knows, everybody knows.
No, the director didn't know. They wouldn't tell me. Suddenly I would see all this mumbling and all this mumbling. What's going on? Oh, nothing, you know, like, let's not make her panic. That was kind of Reese's role, actually. It was sort of shielding me from the chaos.
Mm-hmm.
Like, every time something was going to hit the fan, it would just sound like, I would just be, you know, it would happen behind the scenes, and I would find out much later when it was resolved.
Well, that's probably what makes it look like a French-Indian co-production, as opposed to an Indian film with some French people working on it.
No, yeah. We had a lot of creatives coming from France, but mm-hmm. like,
I mean, the set was really funny because there was constantly three languages being spoken, right?
Yeah.
Because my French crew was, luckily I speak French,
mm-hmm.
so I would speak to my French crew, and then I would speak to them, and then there was also Hindi and Marathi going on in English, and there were times when, you know, when, like, let's say the camera wasn't ready, and Dominique's first AC, also the first assistant camera person, was also French. So they would just start talking in French about the delay or what's going on or whatever. And my first AD would be getting really impatient because he didn't know what was going on, but they didn't have the time to explain to him in English what's going on.
Uh-huh.
So he would be like, can you just go tell me what's going on, you know? So I had to go there and then translate, and then he would translate. And Indian sets have a lot of people. Which mm-hmm. for the French people was like, why are there 70 people on this set? Like, why are you so many? You know? It's 40 degrees, there's 70 people in here. You know?
And it's a two setup, and we have two people in the shot. Yeah.
I mean, or it's like a kitchen, or when you see the film, you'll see when you're in that, in this tiny little corridor where she sleeps, you know. It's a tiny space, and you have all these people all around, and, you know. But they had a really good sense of humor about it, and
it was really great attitude. It was fun for everyone.
Yeah.
So I couldn't help noticing that with five reviews, you have a 100% Rotten Tomatoes rating. Does that have any bearing on your film as you're going around and taking it to festivals? And is it something that you wish you get more reviews, or does that play at where you are with your film now? Is that a consideration at all?
So Rotten Tomatoes, I'm not very familiar with.
Okay.
So I don't really use it.
It's a movie aggregator.
Yeah, I know, but I don't. Yeah. I don't really use it.
Mm-hmm.
It's what I've noticed, which is really interesting and kind of bizarre, actually, is how a film can travel, right? And this film is traveling. It has actually theatrical releases in 20 countries. But what's amazing to me is whether it's language barrier or otherwise, that news doesn't get across. So we have like so many reviews in France. Like, we have great press in France. We have like a 4.2 on Allociné, which is the local aggregator, which is really, really high.
Mm-hmm. We were the 11th film ranked.
Really?
Yeah.
But we also, and like with the fifth film, Indian film in France ever, you know, in terms of the numbers of tickets sold. But what happens is that doesn't cross borders, you know,
right.
somehow.
It's interesting because we think about, well, it's the internet, so it's international. But of course, if you were to look at, you'd see The Guardian from England.
But yeah.
Now, off the top of my head, that's the only foreign paper that I can think of. It's in the Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah, because there's a lot of French reviews. We have French reviews, Dutch reviews, because the film is released in the Netherlands, it's released in Hungary, it's released in Germany.
Japan soon.
Japan's coming up, but all these are other language stuff. But I think actually it's something that one needs to figure out, like when you have, especially if you have good press somewhere,
yes.
you need to get
How
it.
How do we leverage
it?
This?
Because yeah.
mm-hmm. what's interesting is that the film won one Grand Jury Award, but most of the awards that we got are audience awards. Like in Germany, in France, we had two or three,
two
I think. There's one
yeah.
in Mill Valley. There's
mm-hmm.
it's so.
In the Netherlands.
The Netherlands. People connect to the film,
mm-hmm.
but. Just the same way the production, I came on board as a producer because the traditional producer would not believe in a story. No, this cannot happen, ever. If you want it, then we can put a star on this, we can, you know, just package it the way it has to be packaged, and we can produce it. I think for distribution, it's similar in a way, and just knowing us seeing that when it's in a festival, people connect to it. I mean, we had people crying in Mill Valley.
Mm-hmm.
One guy stood up.
Like we had audience members.
It was
mm-hmm.
like I went to India and he was so moved. It was really interesting. But somehow that does not translate in distribution in the US.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That's always, I think distribution is complicated and challenging for independent films, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, especially it's foreign as well.
Right.
You know,
absolutely.
Like independent art house. But yeah, I mean.
Momentum seems to be on your side, though.
I hope so.
The film is Sir, writer-director Rohina Guerra and producer Brice Poisson. Thanks very much for coming and speaking with us. I'm Rick Love at the 2019 Sonoma International Film Festival for the Filmmaker Interview Series here on Sonoma TV.